on by faith and we by prayer. Heaven's eternal days before me, God's own hand shall guide me there. Soon shall close the earthly mission, swift shall pass my pilgrim days. Hope soon change to glad fruit.
Well, good morning. Oh, you're visiting. Let's try that again. Good morning. Oh, that was great. Welcome to Grace. It is so great to have you here and to have you online. You know, there are folks watching and listening all over the place. And if you're online, there's a chat box. I don't exactly know how it works, but it says chat. It says connect. And there are people here that would love to speak with you. And so if you've got prayer requests or needs or just say help, we can do that. And if you are new here, or if this is the first time to Grace here in the building, or even outside as you're listening, we are so glad that you're here. I remember when I was new here, and I went over to somebody and I said, "I'm new, help," and it worked out just great. They showed us where to go, and Betsy's in the back, and she can welcome you as well and tell you how to be here. Who is glad to be able to be here this morning and worship our Lord? Boy, I sure am. I'm really glad to be here. Let's pray, and we're going to start praising God. God, we thank you for the opportunity this morning to come before you with all the chaos and all the noise and all the craziness, that we can calm our hearts and say, God, we are here for you. God, I pray that you would speak to us this morning and that your name would be lifted up in Jesus' name. Amen. Stand with us as we sing. Let's sing together.
Let our praise be your welcome. Let our songs be a sign, we are here for you.
Yes, we are.
We are here for you. Let your breath come from heaven, fill our hearts with your light. We are here for you. We are here for you. To our hearts are open, nothing here is hidden. You are our one desire. You alone are holy, only you are worthy, God. Let your fire fall down. Let our shout be your anthem, your renown. Fill the sky, we are here for you. We are here for you. Let your word move in power. Let what's dead
To the Lord. Boy, I am. I've been fighting all week and losing. But when I turn it over to Him, He wins. He takes care of it. I love this song we have coming up. Let's sing together.
When all I see are the ashes, My name is Tom Olmsted, and I'm the head of school of Coastal Christian School right here on the Central Coast. Something that I love about the Central Coast is that there is a tremendous assembly of church leaders and ministry leaders who get together once a month to just inspire each other, to encourage one another, and to focus on God's Word as an authority in our lives. These leaders all support Christian education. I know that they support Christian education because they have Sunday school. We are a place that is also inspiring kids to grow in their knowledge of who God is, to grow in their love for Him, to grow in wisdom, to develop a biblical worldview. We want the Bible to be the lens through which our children see the world. If it isn't, chaos and confusion will fill that void. And we all know that this worldview development isn't going to happen by chance. We need the church, we need the community helping to inspire kids to embrace God's truth as their own. Isaiah 54:13 tells us, "Your children shall be taught by the Lord, and great shall be their peace." This is the baseline scripture for Sunday school and for Christian education. Even if you don't have children at Coastal Christian School, we would love to have you participate under the bigger umbrella of the capital C Church. We could use your prayer support, we could use your volunteer support, we could use your financial support to help us endeavor to make this school a place where truth and wisdom saturate knowledge for the next 50 years.
Well, good morning. I'm Ben. This is Tom Olmsted. Tom, you're just up on the big screen. We got a celebrity with us today. So, yeah. As a church at Grace Bible Church, we want to partner with missions partners who are doing kingdom work here in the community, and that's part of what we do in our partnerships. We support Coastal Christian, and in fact, Grace Bible Church started Coastal Christian 50 years ago, and a lot of you were there. A lot of you were participants in getting Coastal Christian. You guys have come a long way. So we have Tom up here to tell us a little bit about what they're doing and where they're going for the future. He's been there for 5 years. He's been a huge blessing to our church and to Coastal Christian. So Tom, tell us about what we got coming up.
Well, thank you. It is such a pleasure to be a part of this body as you guys minister to my kids here in this church as well. And this next generation really needs a solid foundation on the truth. And so it takes the Big C Church coming together to make that really happen, because there's a lot of distractions in this world, as you know, for kids. And the foundation to be established on His truth is so important. So we define Christian education as truth and wisdom saturating knowledge. And as you know, for everyone, it's infinitely more important what people believe than what they ever will possess, because they can go gain the whole world, but if they lose their soul, what have they gained? And so we need to have the body come together to invest in these kids and going forward. And so it is exciting, because we are this next weekend celebrating our 50th anniversary. We're having in the morning from 9:30 to 11:30. Everyone's welcome to join us. We're going to be just having a little presentation. We're going to have a little production by our performing arts program. And then we're going to share a little bit of what God has done to just sustain through His faithfulness this work for 50 years. Because just like all of us, I mean, I've lived 50 years, and you have your wears and tears, and but you also have your mountaintops and as well. And so it's been just a beautiful ride to see God bring us to this point. And so we would welcome all of you to come out to our campus. We're on Oak Park Boulevard, 9:30 to 11:30. And then that evening, if you want, you can get on our website, ccspismo.com, and pick up some gala tickets. We're going to have a special celebration. Two other videos you haven't seen, just sharing what God has faithfully sustained, and then how He's going to take us forward in the future. We believe God's already established some strong momentum for helping us expand our campus, and it's really neat to see just how people have come on board to support this through prayer and giving, and we're going to kind of give a vision for where God's hopefully taking us for the next 50 years as well.
Awesome. We support Coastal Christian financially as a church. We got a lot of teachers there. We got a lot of connection.
Yep.
So this gala you guys are doing, what exactly is that?
Well, the gala is going to be at Thousand Hills Ranch. It's going to start around 5:15, and there that night we're going to have a catered dinner. We're going to have some kid presentations. We're going to be able to share, like I said, a couple videos. And those are $50 a ticket. If you are interested in doing that, please get online and pick those tickets up and join us for that special night as well.
Awesome. And if you guys want to know more, they can come talk to you in the hallway after.
Yep, I'll have a table.
Yeah, Tom will be there. Connect with him, and I'm sure he would love to get you connected with Coastal Christian. So I want to pray for Coastal Christian. We're going to pray for Coastal Christian and this next season as they continue to expand and grow and be blessed by God. And for all of you that give, just know that your gifts are multiplied. So thank you for giving online. Thank you for putting offerings in the back. You support the ministry so well, and we see God move. So let's pray for Coastal. Let's pray for the offerings today. Let's continue to worship. So, Father, we stop and we always acknowledge that the whole earth is yours, everything in it, all the people, everything, Lord, this is yours. And so, Lord, we open-handedly want to partner with you and invest in the things that you care about and in the lives of kids. We thank you, Father, that you have been gracious to Coastal Christian. We do pray for the next season that it would be a blessing. Pray that for your glory and for the betterment of our community and for lives changed, Lord, that you would continue to bless Coastal Christian and Tom and the leaders at Coastal. Lord, multiply our offerings. We pray that you would use them and you would expand their outreach for this community for your name's sake. You've been so good to us, and we thank you. Amen.
Precious Redeemer and Friend. Well, thank you. Thank you, Tom. Thank you. The saxophone this morning, that's pretty great. A lot of talented people around here. Oh, my goodness. We are, we're singing songs, and I have the same problem. Sometimes we sing these things, and it's like, yeah, you're the one, and the battle belongs to you, Lord. And, but what happens to us when those ideas really get inside us? You know, we just sung the battle belongs to the Lord, and our world is in a battle. It's gone berserk. I mean, so we sing, Almighty Fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Question, do we believe that? Came across an article this week, which is meant to be more on the humorous side, about words that people are sick of hearing. Words that people are tired of hearing. Words like the new normal. Social distancing. Unprecedented. Right? Trying times. Uncertain times. Essential. How's the word essential? It's ruined. I mean, you don't want to hear it anymore. Or mandates, or vaccines, or unvaccinated, or all these things that we just hear so much about, and we don't want to hear them anymore because they connect us to things that we don't want to think about. But there is a word that I love to hear. There's a word I love to read. I love to hear it said. It's the word believe, or belief. When you hear someone say, you know what, this is what I believe, it leaves the realm of the kind of the out there, and it goes more toward the core of who this person is. Or when someone says, do you believe? Who's ever going to forget? And if you're a little bit on the older side like me, you're going to remember on February 22nd, 1980, when Al Michaels said, do you believe in miracles? That word, that phrase captures us. But there's another thing in that word, the concept of belief, that reveals something about us. It reveals what we actually believe, what we believe, what we don't believe. In the Bible, the word belief is synonymous with the word trust and with the word faith. The Bible in the New Testament, which we're reading right now through in the Bible Project, was originally written in a language called Koine Greek, which was the most common written language of the day, which is why the gospel writers, the New Testament writers, wrote it in the most common language that they could access, so they could know it, write it down, and so a lot of people could read it. And the word that they used that translates as belief in English is the word pistuo. And you'll see pistuo in the New Testament as belief. You'll see it as faith. You'll see it as trust. When Jesus entered Nazareth, and he said he couldn't do no miracles in Nazareth, it's strange to read Jesus confess that there's something he can't do, because he's supposed to be able to do everything. But in Nazareth, I can't do anything here. And the reason was because there was no pistuo in Nazareth. There was no faith. There was no belief. There was no trust. And nothing could happen. So what did Jesus do? Shake the dust off and move on. Because it turns out where he works is where there is belief. Where there is faith, where there is trust. It's at the heart of what he wants for us. But here's the honest truth, about me at least. There are days I believe, and then there are days when I don't believe. There are days I can affirm, Almighty Fortress, you go before us, and nothing can stand against the power of God in Jason Whalen's life. And then there are days when the fortress is weak And Jason Whalen can't confess that he believes because it can be so hard. And I'm just being honest. I know this is going to sound weird to hear me say, but there are times when we don't spend enough energy figuring out where we don't believe, thinking about our unbelief. Because if we could capture the times, the moments where belief is a struggle for us, and we could ask God for help, then I think we might have some breakthroughs. We might see some victory. We may even see God and the power of God move. Friends, we don't want Grace Bible Church to be Nazareth, where he went there and he couldn't do anything. Can I just tell you that there are thousands of churches in the world where Jesus can't do anything? Why? Because he's unwilling? Because he's not capable? Because he doesn't love those people? It's because there's no pistuo there. There's no belief. There's no faith. There's no trust. I don't want to be like that. And because the elders of our church give me the platform to do this, then I'm just going to believe for you that you don't want to do that either. All of us want to see our church soar, our lives soar. Well, we're going to be in Mark chapter 9 today, and we're going to meet a father who had belief and a father who had unbelief, and he's willing to be honest. We are continuing our journey through the Bible. We are in the Gospel of Mark this morning. You entered the Gospel of Mark recently, and Mark's gospel is a gospel of action. It's the earliest gospel. Mark was not a disciple. Mark was a disciple of Peter. All of Mark's information about Jesus comes from Peter. And Peter was a radical. Peter had been celebrated as one who had belief. And Peter had moments in his journey where he had unbelief. Peter was a real guy. And Peter is filling Mark's heart and mind and his hand with a pen to record the life of Jesus. Mark has no time for manger scenes or shepherds or wise men. Mark goes right, verse 1, chapter 1, verse 1. This is the gospel of the Son of God. We're getting straight to Jesus. We see Jesus formed in ministry in chapters 1, 2. Calling of disciples. The Father speaks over his Son. This is my Son with whom I am well pleased. It's beautiful. Jesus is performing miracles. He's teaching all throughout Galilee, all throughout the region. There's an interesting example of something I want you to read this week in Mark chapter 5, or reread it if you've already been there in the Bible Project, but a story about a woman who was bleeding for 12 years. Jesus is walking in a huge crowd. This woman has been ostracized by Pharisees and by the religious leaders because she's ceremonially unclean. So she's supposed to be outside the city. She's not allowed to come to synagogue. She can't shop at the market. She's an outcast. She's religiously rejected. But she's decided that Jesus is the only hope she has. For 12 years, she's been living with this condition, both physically and emotionally. And she decides, here's her plan. If I can just touch the hem of his garment, I will be healed. So she forsakes all the social violations. And in her condition, she goes to him. And there's a crowd, and she manages in some way to just touch the hem, and then she's gone. She's immediately healed. The text says that Jesus, I love this, he sensed that power had gone out for him, like, what happened? He looks around. Who touched my garment? The disciples say, there's millions of people around you. How are we supposed to know who touched your garment? The woman, fearing that she was in trouble, comes again. Not supposed to do this. And she tells Jesus, this is what I put together in my mind that would cure my condition. And Jesus says to her, woman, your faith has made you well. couple of observations, and then we're going to get to chapter 9, because I just love to tell this story. Jesus didn't know who touched him. Some people think, well, he just is doing that to, you know, it's like a show. He wants to put out that he maybe didn't know. And I'm not sure that he did know. This woman had decided, this is what I'm going to do. The whole thing was encouraged, inspired by her faith. Jesus was the power of her healing, but the methodology of her healing was through her faith. And he credits her faith for her healing. She's the opposite of Nazareth. She's the direct opposite of Nazareth. She has convinced herself, against all the social shame she feels in being in this moment, she can be healed, and he's the one, and here's my belief, and here's my plan, and it happened because of her faith. In Mark chapter 9, there's another man who has an ailment of a different kind. It's his son who is struggling. Moms and dads, we can relate to any means we would go to get help for our child. He's demon-possessed. And in this moment, there's a great lesson for us to learn about the faith that God wants to inspire in us. And before we read, I just want to give you something that I'm trying to process. I've heard my whole life, it's not the quantity of your faith, but the quality of your faith. It's not what you believe, but what you believe in that makes all the difference. And I believe that, of course. But I'm beginning to wonder if in the moments when I have unbelief, when I can't trust, when it's too hard to see God through all the chaos in my life, and I got a lot of it, I'm wondering if God wants me in those moments to learn how to have more faith, how to have more in terms of quantity of faith, or maybe in terms of maturity or strong faith. Because there are people in the Bible who had strong faith and weak faith. There are people at our church who have strong faith and weak faith. And I think this story illustrates the fact that God, through Jesus, wants us to have stronger faith. We're going to pick it up in Mark chapter 9, verse 14. I have a few of these verses on the screens for you, the ones I want to really focus on. Jesus, James, John, and Peter have just come down from the mountain of transfiguration, where they saw Jesus and Elijah and Moses have a conversation, and they're pretty in awe of what they've seen. And on the way down from the mountain, the rest of the disciples are having an argument about something that's happened, and this is what we enter into in verse 14. And when the four of them came down from the mountain to the disciples. They saw a great crowd around them and scribes arguing with them. And immediately, all the crowd, when they saw Jesus, they were greatly amazed, and they ran up to him and greeted him. And Jesus asked them, "What are you arguing about?" And someone from the crowd answered him, "Teacher, I brought my son to you, to his followers, for he has a spirit that makes him mute. And whenever it seizes him, it throws him down, and he foams and grinds his teeth. He becomes rigid. So I asked your disciples to cast it out, and they were not able." The disciples were being given the opportunity to free this child from this bondage. Some say that he had epilepsy and that Satan had come alongside to make it even worse. We don't know, but we know he's possessed by spirits. The disciples have cast out spirits before. They, of course, saw Jesus do it. And they're having success sometimes, but I think maybe, and you have to read this into the text a little bit, but the disciples were thinking, we'll do with this one what we've done with all the other ones, and they had their little statement or whatever they do, wave their hand, whatever they saw Jesus do, and they would do it, but this time it didn't work. And there's an argument about whether or not the disciples have authentic faith, even the question whether or not Jesus is the real thing. I think they maybe saw a flaw in him because they did all the right things, they said all the right things, but this boy is still tormented. So what does Jesus say to this, beginning in verse 19, when he begins to challenge the moment? Now, if you were Jesus, what would you do in this moment? You had the power of heaven. The power of God is yours. Well, you'd move toward, well, let's get him healed. And the reason why Jesus does not go straight to his healing is because the healing of this boy is not the point of the story. Let me show you what I mean. He tells him in verse 19, "O faithless generation." Pistuo is the root word of faithless there. "How long am I to be with you? How long am I to bear with you? Bring this boy to me." You see, Jesus sees a crowd, a father and his son. Jesus sees an opportunity to communicate to them what he's been trying to communicate to me my entire life. The question is, where is your faith? A crowd of people who are beginning to wonder, is he real? The disciples who think we did our deal and it didn't work, that maybe there's a greater need here. It's not about the power of God to heal. It's not even about prayer in verse 29. The text is about faith and the reality that there's a father whose son is hurting. And Jesus is central as the teacher trying to teach pistuo, belief, faith, and trust to them. He goes on in verse 20. "So they brought the boy to Jesus, and when the spirit saw him, immediately it convulsed the boy. He fell on the ground." Picture this. He rolled about, foaming at the mouth. I mean, this is a pretty serious scene. If you saw this, you would be like, whoa, 911, somebody help this kid. And sometimes there's humor in the Bible. Verse 21 is kind of humorous to me. Jesus, with this kid flopping around on the ground, moaning and foaming and yelling, he says, "So how long has this been happening to him? Tell me. Tell me, this happen often? Does it happen twice a day, once a what? Just, this is interesting. Tell me, what? How often?" You kind of want to say, "Hey, Jesus, this kid's by hurting himself. Get to work here. He needs help." The father says, "From his childhood," meaning this has been happening for a really long time. We've been living with this for a really long time. You know, so forgive me if I don't have this exuberant, you know, sense of your presence, because your guys could do nothing to help my child. And you parents know how he feels. Verse 22, "It's cast him into fire, into water to destroy him. I've watched this condition, these spirits try to kill my son right before my eyes." You can imagine moments when the fathers had to wrestle with this boy to keep him from killing himself by this demon, to hold on to him, to wrestle with him, to fight with him, to get bruised and hurt, trying to help his kid. And the cry of this father's heart in verse 23, he says, "Jesus, if you can, you help us?" And Jesus says, "If you can, all things are possible for the one who pistuos, for the one who believes, for the one who has faith, for the one who trusts," meaning the one who won't believe, the one who can't trust, the one who doesn't have faith, all things are not possible for that person. This is the lesson. He's challenging what the father believes. That's exactly what he should be doing. Notice he's not consoling him. He's not saying, "Hey, it's going to be okay," or he's not telling him, "Just tomorrow will be better and hang in there." He's not sending them prayer emojis or, you know, heart emojis, I'm with you. He's challenging what this man ultimately believes. And in reading it, he's challenging me in what I ultimately believe. But here's the beauty of this text that's in verse 24. Right away, the father knows exactly what Jesus is trying to do. Right away, immediately, the father of the child cried out and said, I believe, but help my unbelief. The same spirit we saw last week in Matthew 28 when Jesus showed up in his resurrected body, the Bible says that some worshiped him and some doubted. What is going on here? I think this father is saying, we have been through so much. So much has happened. Years of torment with this boy, the wrestling matches, the concerns, the moments, the memories of fire and water. Struggling. It wasn't just the child who was suffering, but it was the dad who was suffering. Can you relate to this? Because I sure can. If we can get real for a second. I have my days, Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief. There was a season in our marriage where my wife was crazy sick. And there are moments when I wasn't sure God even cared. Suffering was so intense. To be the one who watches it, I can relate to, I believe. I know the verses. I can give you all the mantra. I can recite all the Christianese you want. But someone I love is really hurting. And you're not doing anything about it. I love this father. Jesus doesn't rebuke him. I think Jesus is blessed to have this man be honest with him. Story continues, and when Jesus saw that a crowd came running, here's the moment. We're going to do something to communicate to this crowd that faith and belief is central to what God wants for us and from us. He rebuked the unclean spirit, saying, you mute and deaf spirit, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again. And after crying out and convulsing him terribly, it came out, and the boy was like a corpse, so that they assumed he's dead. Isn't that what we do? We always go to what the worst possible scenario is. Now he's dead! Great, great fix, Jesus. You got to imagine, this is, I hope, was a video of this we could get to see one day in heaven, but the massive eye roll, like the kind of eye roll that your kids give you, just way up there. Forehead, you know, rubbing. Oh, my goodness. So Jesus takes him by the hand, lifts him up. He arose, and when they had entered the house, his disciples asked him privately, why could we not cast it out? And he said to them, this kind can only be driven out by prayer. Some translations add prayer and fasting, which is a connotation for connection with the Father, where faith grows. So the issue isn't this boy needs to be healed. The issue is these people at this moment in this scene and these people gathered at a church on October 17th, 2021, need more faith, need stronger faith, especially strong faith when life is not going so well. I can be the greatest Christian on earth if my life is all easy and good. It's harder when it's hard. That's the lesson. That's the point. So I want to leave you with two things as we move to wrap up this morning. The first thing I want to leave you with out of this story is your belief, your faith, your trust is the most important thing about you. It's the number one thing about you, because what you believe will determine what you think, and what you think will determine what you do. If you believe that your marriage has no hope, then you will think thoughts that say, this thing's not going anywhere, and that will drive how you behave, what you do as someone who believes it's hopeless. If you believe in your heart that there's no future, if you think in your heart there's no future, you will act as a person who believes you have no future. If you believe your child or your parent or your friend will never come to faith in Jesus, then you will think that that will never happen, and you will act like it. It's Philippians chapter 4. You basically think, you become the things you think, and you think what you believe. And don't sit here and tell me that you believe everything you're supposed to believe all the time, because you don't. Until Jesus challenges you to get stronger. Believe, this is going to sound weird, but believe harder in him. 12 years of bleeding for that woman in Mark chapter 5. He can heal me. Here's my plan. Here's what I'm going to do. Here's how I'm going to act on my plan. It's going to seem crazy, but if I can just touch it, healed. Her faith made her well. On the sea, in a boat, disciples, Jesus said, we're going to the other side. There's a storm, and they're up and down. Jesus asleep, because Jesus knows what he believes. Disciples terrified for their lives. Wake up, wake up. Don't you care that we're going to drown? And before calming the wind and the waves, Jesus says, can I ask you a question? Where is your pistuo? Where is your belief? Where is your faith? Where is your trust? In Nazareth, no miracles because there's no faith. Praying hard, navigating belief and unbelief, my wife comes out of this condition she's in to become a healer of others. It took a little longer than I would have liked. But you know what happened? Faith got stronger. More pistuo to take on all the other stuff that would come afterwards. What you believe will ultimately determine what you do. So the challenge for us is to take inventory, not like a doctrinal statement, but to compare what you believe with what you face, the names and places and issues you navigate. What do you believe about those things? Who do you believe in? And how strong is it? You can judge how strong your faith is by your temperament when things get hard. Do you flip out? Do you freak out? Do you react? Or can there be a steadiness? Not because the waves and wind aren't blowing, but because we know in whom we believe. We trust him. We have faith in him. Because that's the most important thing about you. The second observation coming out of this is, what are you believing God for today? What are you believing God for in your life? If there's nothing, then we need to pray that God would give you something to believe God for. Because if there's nothing challenging you, how are you going to grow? Recently, I've gotten back into going to the gym, which is miserable, you know. Can I just be honest with you? The gyms are for people that are already in shape. I walk around there and think, I don't belong here. It's so frustrating. You've got that guy in the corner who's doing bicep curls like, oh, look at me, oh, look at me. I want to go run and hide. I don't belong here. But I navigate the shame, I get on the treadmill, and I do my thing because my kids are on my case about it. And you know what? As you exercise, as you work a little harder than you normally used to work in, things get better. Things you get stronger, a little bit more energy. It's helpful. I just got to go out at the time when mostly older people are there, and I feel better about myself. So, you've heard this illustration a gazillion times, but I'm telling you, you have to exercise your faith. I'm believing God that Grace Bible Church will see a wave of conversions to Jesus Christ and baptisms in the next 18 months of our church. I'm believing him for it. We're trying to figure out how we need to take, but if we believe it, if we start with believe, hey team, we're gonna think about how can we do this, and it will drive what we do. Which means I wanna tell the person serving me at the restaurant I'm going to, God bless you, here's a giant tip. Or I wanna tell the guy who fixes my car, thanks for the attention, can I pray for you? I want to tell my neighbors, I want to invite them to things, I want to think about their lives in terms of the kingdom, instead of, we're going to go through the motions as a church, I'm never going to think about Susan across the street, I'm not going to worry about whether she's going to hell or not. Well, my thinking is changing. I'm believing God for that. I'm believing him to move us out of a love for our city to see it changed. Is there something in your heart that you're, I don't know how to put words to it, but you, God, do this. If there's nothing there, please, I'm begging you, put something there. Figure it out. Someone to be healed. Someone to come to Christ. Someone to be made whole again. You think our state and country are in turmoil? Believe God for transformation to happen, because only the gospel can fix all this craziness. Do we believe that? Is that some Christian mantra? We're going to sing it and say it and go home and scream at the TV. That's not helpful. God, give me your eyes here. What do you believe God for? I've got a list. So alongside the things you believe, with the issues you face, put a third column, and here's God, what I'm believing you for. I'm gonna be like the woman who was bleeding, and here's my plan. I'm gonna touch your hem. I'm gonna make a plate of cookies. I'm gonna pray by name. I'm gonna intentionally engage this person, this place. I'm gonna invest in Coastal Christian School. Because I think truth and wisdom that saturate knowledge glorifies God. I'm in. I'm praying for that place. Asking God to do a miracle there. Your faith needs to grow. And if you feel like that guy at the gym who doesn't belong like I do, fight that feeling and go for it. I really think that's what Jesus is trying to get us to see here. Not to be impressed with yet another miracle. We see lots of miracles. We got people being healed. We got bread coming from all the place. We got water being changed. We got it. You got power. We need help because I don't always have faith. So help me believe. Father, thank you for your word. I pray that we would be a people, and all of us, most of us would confess that we love you. We want our lives to count for your kingdom. But every one of us can get stronger. Our faith can grow. There can be more. So God, may the thermometer of our faith rise as the temperature of this world rises. And lead us. May every man, woman, and child in this room take inventory. Do I really believe? Does my life, my thoughts reflect what I believe? And God, I'm stunned. The passage ends with you saying very simply, this kind of opposition, it won't come out through mantras or Christianese. It comes out by prayer. So call us to pray. Call our church to pray and believe for strongholds to be torn down and for Grace Bible Church to be a profound and powerful movement in this community, reaching the lost, healing the sick, believing you, God, for miracles. Because if we believe that anything is possible, then we'll act like it. And I pray we'll do that as a church. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Jason. That demands a response. Let's stand together and let's sing.
Father. arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus
Judah. He's roaring.
So who can stop the Lord? Unless our faith isn't strong enough, because then we can't be stopped. So we're not going to be a church that lets that happen. If you're newer to Grace Bible Church, we are community people that believe. We believe in the scriptures, and we believe in the power of God. We believe that Jesus came, like that song said, to deliver us from our sins. He gave his life that we might be set free. For God so loved the world, he gave his only son, that whoever pistuos, believes, trusts, has faith in who he is, in what he did, that person in that moment for all time will not perish but have everlasting life. And if you're not sure about that in your own life, I'm going to hang out here. I'd love to talk about how when I did that when I was in high school, and maybe you can do it today. For the rest of us, for all of us, Jesus said to that father, if you can, don't you know that all things are possible? And all in the Greek means, nice work. All, every, that Kathy, good job, Kathy. All of it, put it all in there. All of it, every little bit, put it in there. Who believes, pistuos, nothing's impossible. Trust it, believe it, have faith in it, and see what happens. Thanks for coming. Don't forget to visit Tom at Coastal Christian School. Get your ticket for the gala and join me there. I can't wait for that celebration. And I want to give you a blessing before you go on the count of three. Ready? One, two, three. I bless you with this truth. And if that whole thing kind of made you nervous, we do that because in Luke 24, Jesus blessed his followers upon him departing, and we just want to hear from God so bad that this week you would live and think like how you believe. It would show up at home. It would show up at work. You would live this possible journey because of a God who's bigger than that, which is impossible. Take that blessing. Put it in your heart. Have a great week. We'll see you next Sunday. God bless you. Thanks for coming out today.